No one man should have all that power. Literally, no one person in the world should have too much power. Power is quantified in our societies in different ways. Political power, systemic power, financial power, turtle power. All of it's tied to a hierarchical escalator in which we rise up to decisions and actions. But once we have power, how does it affect our brain and behavior? After the theme song.
Still no theme song.
Okay. Let's define power, because it's more of a sociological concept, but anything sociological will have some degree of psychological effect. The definition I'll use is possession of control, authority, or influence over others. Having power over others, or controlling resources that they want, need, or fear, has profound effects on the mind and brain, as does being in a less powerful position. There are countless super light, not traumatizing studies looking at human behavior in positions of power, like the super chill, completely ethical 1971 Stanford Prison Experiment, where a professor by the name of Dr. Zimbardo assigned either guard or prisoner to subjects and basically let human nature have creative control. And the guards abused all of the power, like all of it. They left no power unabused. Or the wildly ethical, completely not whack Milgram experiment, where Dr. Milgram studied how far people would go in obeying an instruction if it involved harming another person. And
he might be dead in there.
People took it to a pretty horrifying extreme, claiming that they were following orders. So, you know, just some light Nazi-ing. Clearly, power corrupts, but what effect does it actually have? Well, it increases hypocrisy, egocentrism, and lack of empathy, which doesn't sound like anyone, right? Right. If it corrupts us, what is it actually doing to our brains? Well, the answer may lie in dopamine. Dopamine is a reward neurotransmitter among a whole score of other functions. It's behind some of our feel-good feelings, and power makes us feel good. Power increases testosterone levels, but that in turn activates dopamine activity. An EEG study from 2012 saw increased dopaminergic activity in the left prefrontal cortex in individuals primed to think about a situation where they had power over another person. So if power is linked to reward, that might explain why it's so hard to give up. Releases of dopamine in your brain is reward-oriented, and when you get dopamine, you want more and more. It's a large focus of addiction research. People want that high, whether it's a drug, a feeling, or both, like a Wolf of Wall Street type high, all the money and power, and then all the cocaína. This is where the neurochemistry of power comes into play. More power comes with more resources, which could be more money, more subordinates, etc., etc. That same dopamine can enhance cognitive function, but also may make people more impulsive, less risk-averse, and less empathetic. Sound familiar? It should. Philosopher of neuroscience Nayef Al-Rodan suggests that in a power paradigm, high levels of dopamine are associated with a sense of personal destiny, risk-taking, preoccupation with a cosmic or religious, and emotional detachment that can lead to becoming more callous and singularly focused on achieving goals. There's nothing wrong with ambition. We should all want to do stuff. Stuff is always good, but there's truth to the phrase that power corrupts, and it doesn't take a Dr. Zimbardo to expose that. Having a degree of power causes people to detach from humanity in a way, lowering the ability to comprehend how other people see, think, and feel. Also known as another idiom, walking in another person's shoes. Further research out of Canada put people with and without power in a transcranial magnetic resonance machine and found that power impaired a specific neural process that we'll call mirroring, which people think is key in having and expressing empathy. Empathy is a key part of being a human being, yes, but it's also important in campaigning for office, knowing what your constituents see, think, and feel, and running on those issues and platforms. But it seems that as power increases, this sort of empathic response deteriorates, and when subjects with power are asked to act empathically, they're often really, really bad at it. Why? Well, some theorize that an increase in power lessens the need for an understanding of people with less power because it gives them access to resources that they didn't previously have, like that friend acting differently when they found a higher class of friends with more social status, or started acting differently when they finally got some bread, or lettuce, or cheese. Why is everything about money also about sandwiches? The science behind it suggests that powerful people may be hooked on power, losing the ability to have genuine empathy and becoming myopically focused, and that's not just politicians. Need a key to staying grounded? Research says have a tether, reminding you not to believe your own hype. Mine's my mom, my friends Karen and Rhonda. This episode is brought to you by your hype. Don't believe it. Rainbow. Okay, so you're in a powerful position and you're making people under you feel like they're not as powerful. Well, watch this video about rehumanization so you don't see them as objects. Come on, man, you can do better. Just watch the video. Thanks for watching and make sure to subscribe, dude. I'm asking nicely. You won't like me when I'm angry. I just get softer.